Hey everybody, it's Karyn Bryant. Welcome to the MMA Heat podcast. I'm here with
Pete Cummins.
And we've got a big show today.
First show in 2 weeks.
Yeah, I know. We weren't able to do one last week. I'm sorry. I'm sure you guys missed us. We're sad. We're going to have Raquel Pennington on with us. She is fighting at UFC 184. She is fighting Holly Holm in Holly's first fight in the UFC. And Rocky is the co-main event. She and Holly are fighting in the co-main event. And Ronda and Kat are the main event. It's historic, Pete. Two chick fights at the top of a UFC
chick
card.
Chick night. Ladies night.
It's ladies. Oh, I can't sing it because we can't pay for that. I was going to sing ladies night, though, and we all know that song. That is a great song. We also are going to have on Liam McGeary. Liam is fighting for the Bellator light heavyweight title on Friday night. He's taking on Emmanuel Newton at Bellator 134. Great guy, so we're going to catch up with him as well. So it's a big show. See, we took some time off, Pete, but we're coming back with a 1-2 combo.
It's incredible. And the fact that it's still free.
Still free. I know some people would pay I can't even say that with a straight face. People would pay good money for this.
People would pay.
Like a nominal fee.
A quarter?
Yeah.
Would you pay a quarter? If you're still watching this at this point, you can throw in a quarter.
For the coffee fund here.
Buy some on it.
And mayheat.com/on it will give you 10% off. Good stuff. You still probably haven't taken it, though, have you? Give it back. If you don't want the alpha brain, give it to somebody who will use it.
I want the alpha brain. I just have my lab testing it to make sure that it's safe.
Yeah. You're breaking bad lab. What are they?
Listen, you've been taking Alpha Brain, and you know I'm just saying it's inconclusive.
It's good, no. And I'm living 2015. I'm running more. I've got look at my mm-hmm. My steps today. Mm-hmm. I got my little Samsung thingy. I'm at 6689 okay. steps already today.
You ready? 6 times 7.
It's 42.
All right, pretty good. 8 times 7.
56. What does that have to do? I didn't take the alpha brain today. I actually didn't take it today.
Okay. All right.
I didn't.
How's the new mood working?
Oh, great.
Yeah. I mean, you do seem to be perky.
I am. I had some weird dreams the other day. But anyway, so we got a big show for you to do. Looking forward to this weekend, February 27th, 28th, to Fight Nights. It's going to be great. And actually, Friday night is so jam-packed. There's an Invicta show here in L.A. too. I'm a busy girl this weekend. It's like fight action. But last night, on Sunday night, we had a UFC fight night. Frank Mir versus Bigfoot Silva. And actually picked correctly in this one. We were at work, and I was working with Brian Stan and Michael Bisping. They both went with Bigfoot, and we were sitting around in our avocado room prepping, and I was like, you know, I'm feeling Frank Mir in this one. Like, I'm feeling Mir. But listen, the odds in that one were close. Right. It could have gone either way. Yeah. I'm not saying I'm like some genius who called like the biggest dog in the world.
Is sitting around the avocado room, is that a euphemism for you didn't make your prediction on camera?
No, actually, they don't ask me to usually because I'm the moderator of the conversation. Right. You know, those are the professional fighters.
So we really have no
idea. But the professional fighters were wrong last night, and Little Miss Chick here was correct. It wasn't a long fight. But you know what it was? You know, Frank is a cerebral guy, and a lot of time you hear fighters talk about their camp and this and that, and it just sounds like BS. And some of what he said might have been truthful and some of it wasn't, but what sold me was that it had been such a long layoff. And listen, the guy was coming off of 4 losses in a row. It's like do or die time. Right. But he fights the best there is. So it's one of those tricky things. It's like, well, yeah, you lost, but you lost to number two. You know what I mean? You're fighting the best there is. But there was something that he had said about really healing up his body. He said he realized he went to a yoga class with his wife, couldn't do downward dog for more than a couple minutes. And then he's thinking, okay, I'm supposedly a prime athlete, you know what I mean, a fighter, and I can't do this. And he had so many things messed up in his body that for the camps leading up to the fights, which he then lost, he said he would work around all these injuries. Oh, my shoulder's bad, so we're just going to train this other stuff. And so you sort of overcompensate, undertrain, your body's not whole, And so I liked what he was saying about being able to come back as a more unified athlete and a healthier person, and it showed off. I thought he looked good. Bigfoot looked so timid and shy, didn't even like throw anything. You're not going to win. You miss 100% of the punches you don't throw, to give my best Yogi Berra.
Now, I want to ask this question in the utmost respect. Bigfoot.
Yes.
Does he have, like, gigantism?
Yes, he does. He does. Okay. Yes, he has a pituitary. He had to have surgery on it. There's an issue with the pituitary gland, so he actually did. Yes, no, he's a giant man. He's a very big man, which is why before his reasoning for taking TRT and various supplements was because he had to deal with this issue.
Gotcha.
But then the UFC said, oh, guys are not going to be able to get TRT replacements anymore. He actually had to then go to have surgery, which he wouldn't have had to do if he could have still taken the treatment.
Right.
And listen, that's one concern people have is the guy that was able to have his replacement could go five rounds with Mark Hunt. The guy that it can't gets knocked out in a minute and 40. And listen, Mark Hunt throws harder than Frank Mir, I'm willing to bet. You know, it's sad. It makes people question a lot of things.
Right. And what did you think about that left hook, too? It didn't look that devastating.
No, that's why it was so weird. It was like, wait, no, he just went down.
Well, also,
it was a jab and then a follow-up.
It kind of, like, it didn't come from downtown.
No, it was a jab and then a follow-up because we were talking about on the show after Michael was showing with Bryant, like, yeah, you jab somebody, then their reflex and stuff like that, they kind of move. And if you follow right back up, you can, I didn't mean to do that. So you can follow right back up while they're sort of off in open, you know what I mean? Which is what happened, but we were like, you can't fell Bigfoot with a jab.
Yeah, I was a little surprised.
Yeah, a little bit surprised. And in the co-main event, though, this one, and again, like I said, I'm not claiming I'm some savant for picking Bigfoot to lose, but everybody else in the room had picked him, and I went with Frank, so I was correct in that one. But
I mean, you kind of are claiming a little.
I am claiming because the problem is I need to record these things when I'm in the avocado room. Because the other thing that I said was, we were watching Cesar Mutanchi and Sam Alvey, and Cesar's winning the round. Caesar's landing stuff, getting in there, sneaky up elbows, and all this stuff. But I noticed that every time he went in, like wide open over here, wide open, and I was like, pretty sure he's going to get tagged with a counterpunch. Dropped. Just laid out.
You know,
I know a couple of things.
I predicted the internet in 1986.
Oh, shut up. Because you don't. Listen, I spent enough time. I've done this now for quite some time, you know. I learned.
I'm not saying that I don't believe you, Karyn.
But you're saying it's not 100% of a truthful conversation. I swear to God, I'm going to start filming this stuff then. When I'm in the green and I'm saying, this is what I think is going to happen, and boom, there it is. Why do you doubt me?
No, Pete, what have I
told you that hasn't been true?
Okay. I didn't know we were going to have this long a podcast, but first of all, I just want to say that I love Sam Alvey.
You do? Sam?
That's the first time I'd ever seen him fight, and when I saw him walk out there, I was like, oh my God, like, Opie Cunningham, somebody pull that boy back. It's the neighbor's kid. He somehow crawled into the octagon. He's going to get out. Timmy's in the octagon. Get him out. And then he looks like he's getting his butt kicked.
And another person who didn't really throw anything until he threw the one thing that he needed.
Yeah. Now, his was a good shot.
It was a fantastic shot.
But they need to drug test him. Because anyone who's smiling that much, he's just like...
He's a funny guy. Like, I'm going to try to get him on the podcast. So I think it'd be fun to have him
on. Yeah, I'd love to have him on.
But that's his whole thing, when you hear from him, he was talking in the post-fight interview, like... He's literally just a joyful, happy person. He's like, listen, I get to do something that I would do for free. Like, he loves what he does. It's just pure joy. It's just a little off-putting to see somebody that happy to go in there and get face punched. Like it's a little weird.
I mean, I can see a guy like playing guitar going, you know, a rock star. I would do this for free, but you know, there's a fighter and he's like, hey, this is fun.
It's
like,
weird.
So he's on New Mood.
He's on the New Mood. Special stuff. I don't know. But do you know what else is interesting about him? I don't know if you saw his wife with him. She corners him.
She works the corner.
She won America's Next Top Model. Okay. And they have a couple kids together, so she corners him. I want to know your theory on that. You know, obviously, my husband and I work together. You know that. Everybody knows that. Most people know that. If you don't know that, my husband is the one doing all the technical stuff for me and doing the camera work and editing and stuff. But, like, I don't know that I would. Well, he did a smoker fight one time, and I screamed my lungs out because I was like, "Kick!" And it was very difficult for me to sit there and watch him not do what I knew he could do.
Right.
You know what I mean, in terms of fighting and stuff. Would you want your wife to be your corner person?
Well, I would probably get the shit kicked out of me, so I'm gonna go with no. I would not want my wife to be.
Because I'm feeling like if things are going badly, then do I really want to look up and see my husband, like, nagging me to, like, do this? I haven't told you to do it. Like, shut. That's not when I want to see my husband. I'm sorry.
And that's why you can't.
Yeah.
You know, and that's why, yeah, the answer would be no. Because there's, like, words like nag you say about your spouse, but you can't tell your coach, like, will you stop nagging
me? Right, right. Your coach is your coach.
You know, and there's things like, there's ways you can't talk to your spouse. Like, don't talk to me that way. I don't appreciate your tone. I don't deserve that tone of voice. Honey, we're in between rounds of a title fight here. How can I say it nicely? How can I say it respectfully?
Yeah, and granted, I don't know how much strategizing she's doing in there. She might just be, you know, helping him get water and stuff. But it's interesting, and it's a
helping
weird thing.
Him get water. You just sent women back 25
Why?
Years. Hey, you know, the honey, I don't know what she's doing in there, helping
him
get water.
I don't know if she's strategizing.
Is she doing her nails in there, looking pretty? I don't know.
One thing that is a little odd, and if we have him on, I would like to ask him about this. He and his wife look very similar. If you look at other pictures of her, she's a lovely girl. She used to have a different hair color, but hers is red, and his is red, and it's a little strange. They look very much like each other, which is another thing I find a little.
And his wife won America's Top.
Yeah.
Okay.
She's pretty. If you Google her, and you look at her pictures, McKee, what is her last name? I forget. These pictures, I mean, she's very photogenic. Yeah. But I do think
no wonder you're smiling. Don't tell us because you enjoy fighting.
Yeah, worst case scenario. But here's the thing, and I guess it is it's a double standard. You know, a lot of times there are a lot of female fighters, and their coach is also their significant other outside of, you know, fighting. Right. But you really don't see that the other way around. So, like, you see a bunch of dudes coached by chicks, right. And, oh, yeah, my wife's my coach. And I guess that's just the double standard of why it seems weird.
Does she work as corner or is she his coach? I mean, there's a big difference.
That's what I'm saying. I don't think she's his coach. I know she's not his coach. He trains at Dan Henderson's gym.
Right.
She, you know, he's a Team Quest guy. You know, she's not in there holding, I don't think she's holding.
So, big, but so what is she doing in his corner?
I don't know. That's what I'm saying. I think maybe it's a comfort thing, and it's just like I don't know. That's why I need to have him on the show.
We're gonna ask him.
I got these questions. But Michael Johnson looked awesome against Edson Barboza, and not for nothing, Michael Johnson was on this show.
I think we have like a little winning streak.
We might have
on
a little bit of a golden touch going on lately.
If you wanna win, you come on this show.
Here you go. He looked awesome, you know, and it's funny because we talked to him about it, and you guys can obviously go back and check out that podcast. We talked to him about his layoff, and you know, he said, you know, just because time off from fighting, you know, in the octagon doesn't mean time off from training and getting better and better and better. And that's the thing, is he was just really able to neutralize Edson Barboza's kicks, because Edson is the sickest kicks in the game,
right.
And he just really took that out of the equation. And Michael, I thought, just looked terrific.
I mean, definitely helped that he's a southpaw.
Yes.
But he was relentless with his pressure.
Yeah.
I mean, and that takedown with 10 seconds left in the fight seals the deal. It was great.
It's good. Yeah, and he called out Benson Henderson after, which I like.
By the way, great fight he had.
Oh, dude, yeah, Benson. Yeah, Benson rocked it against Brandon Thatch. But, Benson is a different animal because of his grappling and his ability to scramble and things like that. So, Benson, has other tools that, Michael, if he's going to fight somebody like Benson Henderson, and we didn't really get to see too much of the ground stuff yesterday, I would just want to make sure that was up to speed, because Benson is ridiculous when it comes to the grappling. So that would be fun, though.
And Cody
Gibson, Google me. Cody.
Cody, Google me, bitch.
Right.
Listen. Didn't do particularly well, but toughed it out.
He didn't win.
No, he didn't win, but
the Googling is not going so well for him. Otherwise, on that, the women's fight was good. Jessica Andrade and Marion Renault. Marion Renault, did you? 37 years old. 37. Wow. And kicking butt like that. Like,
Four years older than me.
You are such a liar. The fight was not going her way at first.
Right.
But she hung in there, scrambled. I mean, I love that she's, and because I'm doing the announcing on the, doing some stuff for Fox, and I was like, man, she's 14 years older than Andrade, right? And we were just like, that could, I don't know, we'll see how it plays out. But man, she just came in wrecking.
37,
and looking like that much of a badass. And she won a fight in January also. So that's two fights she's won in the UFC inside of like 6 weeks.
Wow.
Badass.
So listen, I got to ask you a question.
Yes.
I'm watching you on Fox Sports 1.
Yeah.
And the other guys, the other sports guys, made a joke about the pointer
yes.
which Bisbing had broke like a week earlier.
Yes, he did.
And all three of you guys on cue gave like that really fake sports analogy. Like,
did we?
Anyway.
Oh no!
Yeah, so,
I don't know. It's funny. No,
you
I love
pretty
James.
Good. You have a pretty good fake
did
sports
we?
Analogy.
It wasn't fake.
So anyway.
No, they were not. Yeah. Jay and Dan are totally cool. They're fine.
Oh, no,
yeah,
I'm not saying
great.
That they weren't cool. But, he was sort of thrown out a joke that he'd already done the week before.
All right, but I don't know. What was I supposed to do? What was
no,
I supposed
I was,
to do?
I was impressed. All three of you gave a synchronized. So, anyway, back to.
Well, sometimes, Pete, I need to. We can't go back and forth for 10 minutes. I got to get on with the shoe.
I'm just keeping an eye
really?
Out.
So now
if
I'm
you
a,
me
a phony
like a,
liar. You've already accused me of being a liar right at the get-go of the show. I'm a liar.
More
today.
Than
and
exaggerated.
Now I'm also fake.
I'm a fantasist.
Are you
a
sure fantasist. You're not the one commenting in these all the time? She's so fake. What a fake smile. She's so fake and all her fake laughing.
Really?
Some people
you
think
get
that.
Those comments?
Yeah, which is...
See, they love you compared to me. At least you know.
No, on that, not on this, but like on some interviews, and it's hilarious to me that they think I'm fake laughing. Like, literally, I could be interviewing somebody. By the way, Sheck Congo, perfect example. Sheck is fighting also at Bellator 134, the same one as Liam, who we're going to have on the show. We put out a clip with Sheck. This week where he's talking about his fight. He's fighting King Mo. So you should definitely check that out on my YouTube channel here as well. But, I love Sheck. Like, the guy cracks me up. But, sometimes we'll do stuff and people are like, oh, he's got that fake laugh. Are you in my head? How do you know when I'm faking?
Prove to me and everyone, next time you're doing Fox Sports and they throw you over with a corny joke, just have a really... Yeah, whatever, Bob. Anyway.
So, who's paying for my daughter's tuition then?
Or like, just...
get fired. KB, I'm going to need you to go out and get fired to prove a point.
Or just... or just go like this. Anyway.
Wicked funny.
Listen.
Yeah, no, listen, I really do have a good day. So anyway, that also brings up another thing I wanted to mention to you guys. We have a really great feature with Alan Joban. Coming up, he's also fighting at UFC 184. So we shot with him. We went all over the place with Alan Joban. We got him training at Black House. We have him training with Eddie Bravo down in LA. Wade even went to the cryotherapy place with him and went in there. So
is that where they freeze?
Yeah. He goes down to -240, 220, 245 for 2 minutes, dude. So not doing that.
-245 degrees for two. Because isn't like absolute zero like where the cells stop moving and objects like negative 373.
Something like that. The whole theory is that you start to force your organs to get oxygenated and more blood in them and stuff. It's a bunch of hocus pocus, but apparently he loves it. Alan loves it, goes all the time.
For 2 minutes.
Yeah, that's all. Well, it's instead of taking an ice bath for an hour, he goes and does the cryotherapy for 2 minutes.
Yeah, but an ice bath isn't minus 240.
No, that's why you got to stay in for an hour. And eventually they're like, that actually sucks worse because you're just cold now for an hour.
And it's really minus 245.
Minus 240. Okay. Watch the video.
I did a minute and a half and then I did it for 2 minutes.
He did it.
And we
cold as hell. But I tell you what, about 10 minutes later, my wrists have been aching, and the aching went away.
Yeah.
My wrists felt great.
Yeah.
For about 2 days afterwards, and then it started coming back.
There's got to be, like, if you have, like, a weak heart or something, that's got to screw you up.
Well, I asked Alan about it, so if you guys are curious, check out the interview with Alan Jovan. Yeah, we talk about his upcoming 184 fight. We talk about the whole PED situation in the UFC. We talk about what Josh Koscheck had said about him when Josh took his teeth out when we were on Fox. Very cool. And we're putting out, we also hung out with Tony Ferguson, El Cucuy, super cool guy. He is also on UFC 184, so we'll be putting that one out this week as well. So please circle back around and look for that one. That one is in the editing bay right now, people.
Cool. Well, that's industry term
for
they haven't finished.
Wade hasn't done it yet. Yeah. As I've already pointed out,
he slept in, and
as you remember, I've already let everybody know that he is the technical genius.
Anything that goes wrong, it's Wade's.
Don't tweet me when stuff isn't online yet.
Yeah.
He answers the MMA Heat Twitter, so hit him up,
dude. It's really all on Wade's shoulder.
It's not.
Kind of.
Dude, here we go. It's so not. Really? Really? We don't want to have this conversation about what's really going on. We're going to bring in Rocky Pennington now. I need some backup, so I'm going to bring in a cool chick so that it's a fair fight here.
All right.
Rocky is taking on Holly Holm at UFC 184, so let's get her going. All right, everybody. Well, we've now got Rocky Pennington on with us, and of course, she is taking on Holly Holm at UFC 184 in the co-main event. So, listen, Rocky, obviously my first question to you is, you know, we were excited about the Chris Weidman Vitor Belfort fight, but all of a sudden, as soon as that falls out, you must have like been like, oh my God, sweet Jesus, I'm the co-main event now. How good was that news?
It's an exciting feeling. It's pretty surreal. It sucks for Chris Weidman to obviously sustain an injury. That's never fun as an athlete.
Mm-hmm.
But, for what it did for our fight and boosting us up to the co-main event, it's overall exciting. I mean, throughout most of my career, I always fought towards the end of the card, so it was always nice to have more time to kind of relax.
Mm-hmm.
So it'll be nice to be able to do that. As far as, like, the pressure of the co-main event and stuff, I mean, I kind of try to put that to the side. I try to just put the pressure off to the side.
Yeah.
And then afterwards, I'll jump for joy.
Right. Because and it's funny because I was texting with Rocky last night, like during some of my breaks yesterday working on the Fox stuff. And we did this whole thing where we hyped up her fight. And then I'm texting with her. And it's funny because Holly Holm is friends with Bryant Stan. So after we were talking about it, he was on with her. And I'm talking to you. But I said on the show, and I feel like, I know a lot of people are excited. But as a woman, to see the co-main a main event as women in a UFC event to me is such, that's just awesome. So I'll be jumping around while you're playing it cool.
Sounds good.
But it's pretty great. So here's the deal. Holly Holm, professional boxer. I know this is a fight you asked for and you were supposed to have it before. You know, why did you want to fight her so badly?
You know, I mean, there's multiple reasons. I like the challenge.
Mm-hmm.
I like the challenge that every woman brings to the table. Everybody brings something different. As far as Holly Holm, I feel like she's a phenomenal athlete. I mean, she's been athletic her whole entire life.
Yeah.
She's done great things in boxing. She came into MMA, and she's done great things against the girls that she's gone against. I feel like she's riding huge Kai train coming into this.
Mm-hmm.
I don't really feel like she's actually fought on, like, the elite level. I don't feel like she's fought against the tough chicks that are into the UFC, and I mean, it's exciting. I feel like she has all the pressure coming into this. I have nothing to lose but to go out there and have fun and fight my fight. And, you know, I feel like a lot of people, I mean, I still haven't been able to take that fighter from the gym into the cage. And I think when it comes to this fight with Holly, that's definitely going to come out because I feel like she thinks that she's going to dominate me in all areas. I mean, not just stand-up. Of course, she came into MMA for obviously all aspects of the sport. But, you know, when somebody's in danger, that's what they rely on. They rely on their roots. Mm-hmm. And she's a boxer. I'm not worried about boxing people. I'm not worried about brawling with people. Yeah. So I think the toughness in me and the heart and the determination and then all my skills and technique, I think it's definitely going to play a huge role. And I just want to showcase who I really am. So it's pretty much why I asked for this fight.
Nice. Now, does that mean, though, yeah, you said something interesting there. You wanted to take the fighter from the gym into the octagon, and you don't feel like you've done that yet. And so you don't really feel that we've seen everything that you have to offer yet?
Oh, not even close. Yeah. I don't know what
it is. That's scary news for all the other girls. I hate to tell them.
I don't know what it is. For some reason, like, every opponent, there's something little that they'll bring out. Or I've always had the bad habit of dropping to a comfort level of where my opponent's fighting at.
Okay.
And doing enough of what I need to do to either win, or I didn't even do enough at the time, and that's why I lose.
Okay.
I still haven't taken that athlete that's just a freaking maniac in the gym. Super talented, has a ton of skills in my toolbox. Mm-hmm. I mean, I haven't taken half of that out. It's just something here and there. So
yeah.
I think as far as overall with this fight with Holly, I mean, the fight has to start standing up, but it can go a million other places. Mm-hmm. And it's exciting for me because it's just, I don't have to worry about, I mean, I don't feel like there's a whole lot. Obviously, I'm not going to take away from her, and she's going to be talented.
Yeah.
The fight's going to be hard. It's going to be a fight.
Yeah.
But I don't know. Like, I think just with the more that my career is progressing, I'm getting more comfortable in the cage, mm-hmm. and I'm starting to get that relaxed feel to where I'm just going to be able to start really showcasing who I am as I'm building up.
Nice. Well, and I was talking about this was because Bryant has trained with Holly, and that was my first question, was sort of like, well, isn't she going to have a disadvantage on the ground? And certainly she's been training, and she trains with John Jones' wrestling coach, Izzy, and, you know, certainly she's prepared for that, but not as prepared as you are. So I feel like, you know, most people think that you will have a very clear advantage on the ground. But I get the sense that you kind of want to stand and bang a little bit and show her what you have because most people think she's going to have such a great advantage boxing.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I'm completely the underdog. Hey, yeah. I really don't care. I don't care about people's opinions. Like I said, I mean, I'm not worried about it.
Yeah.
The same way that she's over there training with John Jones and world-class coaches and all this other stuff, I'm doing the same thing mm-hmm. here in Colorado Springs. I mean, I got the Olympic Training Center,
yeah.
WCAP, which is the world-class athlete program, and we've been bringing in a ton of people, world-class athletes, Olympians from everywhere, mm-hmm. and just constantly having a different challenge, facing things. The same way that, I mean, not only have I been facing girls that are my size and bigger, yeah. I've been challenged by so many different guys that are Olympians mm-hmm. and professionals. So, I mean, I think I just really challenged myself a lot that I wanted to correct as far as this fight camp and stuff. I did. Mm-hmm. I mean, I completely corrected it and progressed like no other. That, you know, in grappling and stuff and on the ground, yeah. you develop a wicked strength. I mean, you could look at wrestlers that are 120 pounds and you wouldn't think these guys would do anything to you.
Yeah.
And let them get a hold of you. And with everything that they've built over the years within their body.
Yeah.
I mean, it makes them tough.
Oh, yeah.
And I feel like that's something that I do have an advantage over. I've mm-hmm. been in MMA for over 8 years. I'm very comfortable on the ground. I've become really good at wrestling.
Mm-hmm.
And since Ultimate Fighter, I mean, I've become really comfortable. I'm starting to really learn what my hands can do.
Yeah.
And we were making jokes in this last fight camp because, I don't know, my strength and conditioning coach, what he's been putting me through and the challenges I've been facing, and the more that I've actually been getting comfortable, I always had a bad habit of backing away from opponents and mm-hmm. then kind of striking, doing different things. And now that I'm actually comfortable where I'm at, I've learned to really brawl, cut angles, do a lot of things, and my little hands can't handle the power that comes behind it.
Yeah.
It's been a brutal fight camp.
Oh, really? So you've hurt your own hands?
Oh, yeah.
Pete, she's that much of a badass that she hurt her own hands because of the force. That's awesome. Like, I kind of love that.
And it's not even punching wrong either.
He has a hangnail today that he's pretty upset about. I'm sorry, Pete. It's just you're an easy target. It's funny to me. You know, it's funny because we were saying this yesterday about you, which is why I think why you earned so many fans on The Ultimate Fighter and why, you know, Dana loves you and why the fans are like, you do. You just bite down on the mouth guard and you're like, I'm in it. Like, she, you know, you're fearless. And that's something that I think is why people respond to you so well. Do you get that sense?
Well, the last time I saw you, you had a giant gash down your forehead.
Yeah.
Brutal.
And I was eating like a cheeseburger at the time going like, oh, whoa, and you kept fighting and pulled it off. And I mean, it looks good now. Looks like your doctor did a good job or something.
For sure. But have you always had that sense of fearlessness? I mean, well, like I said, maybe in your head you're not fearless, but that's how it looks to us.
Yeah, it's funny. We were actually talking about that today, how everybody's like, you're always so composed and all this other stuff. And I'm like, oh, if you really knew what was going on. I mean, the emotions that I face and stuff leading up to a fight. But like I said, I mean, yeah, for the most part, I would go out there. I'm a gamer.
Yeah.
I go for it. I stay composed. And I mean, like I was saying, I really haven't fought my fight. And that's what I've learned. I've learned to let that fear go and just be comfortable with the fighter that I am. Yeah. And now that I've learned that, like, it's just, I don't know, I feel like a complete different person, a complete different athlete. And it's been from my last fight camp and this fight camp that's completely changed. I mean, training with these world-class athletes and these Olympians, like, the mentalities that they carry and just being around that all the time has really put an impact on me. And to see athletes like that who just really, I mean, we really help each other grow. Mm-hmm. And I've gone against girls and guys that's been boxing one of them's been boxing since she was like 5.
Damn.
And I was like, oh, okay, here we go. Like, I'm going to get tore up. And I mean, you know, there's been all these athletes doing phenomenal things.
Yeah.
And really, it's just made me feel that much better about myself because when I go out there and I face that challenge, the first time we maybe go, I get nervous.
Yeah.
And because I'm stepping into their world. But then all of a sudden I'm like, you know what? Just relax, bite down on your mouth guard, do what you do. And ever since I've been doing that, it's just been, I've surprised myself.
Yeah.
So it took me to surprise myself and to figure that out to actually stand where I'm at now. And I mean, it just, I'm like, I'm excited. I'm like, man, the fight's right around the corner. Yeah. It's exciting.
It is exciting. Well, and your last win was one of those, like Pete said, you know, you got this great cut and you're digging out. I mean, was it 2 seconds left on the clock? How many seconds were left when the fight was actually called off?
He didn't stop it until, I mean, after the bell.
Yeah, but I feel like it came like...
It was like under 4.
Yeah. I feel like... I mean, and it was just... You were just like, bitch, I'm done.
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, when it came to that fight, I was actually pretty excited because even though she may have had me up against the cage and stuff, I actually felt completely in control of everything that was happening. I mean, you can go back and watch the fight, and technique-wise, I was doing everything completely right.
Mm-hmm.
And I was actually really composed, really calm in that fight. I just, that's why I said I really grew in my last fight camp. And I remember as soon as I took that hit to the head, it didn't hurt, it didn't faze me. And then I look down and it's just like gushing blood.
Yeah.
I was like, okay, here we go. And I look at my coach and he's like, urgency, like do something. So I was like, all right, here we go. And the minute I spun her onto the cage and I was trying to get head control, like I put the blood all in my eyes and then I was just blind after that. I didn't know blood can like burn and make you blind. But I couldn't really see what I was doing. I just had to fill it out.
Yeah.
Went to town and in that time, I mean, I just had to trust my instinct and trust my training.
Mm-hmm.
That's exactly what I did. And I remember when I got the double leg takedown on her, I let her crawl back up, and I remember thinking in my head in her videos how when she gets back up, she kind of gives up her back.
Yeah.
And for some reason, every time my training partners were doing that in camp too, I would just snatch the choke like that. Sometimes, I mean, it can be a stupid move if you don't land it right.
Yeah.
It's pretty much a stupid move to do, but if you land it solid, it's brutal, as everyone saw.
Right.
And I had to go. I mean, every single second in the cage counts, and those last 10 seconds, as soon as I heard that, I was like, oh, you have plenty of time.
Yeah,
so much can happen in those seconds.
Yeah,
and sure enough, there it was.
That's so awesome. Because, well, that's the thing, you know, they'll stop a fight for a cut. I understand why your coach gets urgent because, you know, that's not how you want it to end. And, I mean, you could have your ear halfway hanging off. And you're like, you know, that's how girls are. They're like, no, let me bang, you know. It's tough. Did you watch, obviously I know you watched last night. We have some new, you know, not that they're new, but she's had 2 fights in the UFC, Marion Renault. She looked good last night. I'm just curious what you think. You know, obviously on your card you have Ronda and Kat fighting, but there's some girls in there trying to make a name for themselves. Betch Cajeda doing some good things. Are you seeing, you know, some other fights that you might like to line yourself up with, or other girls that you feel like, wow, you know what, our division's really starting to get a lot more competitive and a lot deeper?
Yeah, you know, the 35-pound division's always growing. Mm-hmm. It's exciting. I mean, we started out really small, and that's never fun when you only have maybe 10 people to compete against. But now that it's really growing and the new talent's coming around,
yeah,
it's definitely an exciting feeling. I sit here and I want to work my way to the top, obviously. My number one goal is to one day fight for the title. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, I do want to fight every single girl in the weight division.
Yeah.
I mean, every girl's going to bring a new challenge, and I want to face that.
Right. That's cool, man.
It reminds me a lot of my hangnail.
Okay.
You know, when I had to do this, I just said, bite down on your mouthpiece, Pete. Muscle through the interview.
Muscle through.
Doesn't matter that you have a hangnail.
You can do it. You can do it. You know, well, you will have this great advantage, too, on Saturday, you know, with Holly. Not, even though she's favored, you know, this is her debut, you know, in the UFC, and there was all this hype around her, is all this hype around her, and, you know, if you haven't, if people talk about octagon jitters for anybody, regardless of where you are in the card, that's a heck of a lot to bite off. I think, yeah, I'm going to just walk right into the UFC in the co-main event against a girl who just totally is a total badass, and that's a lot. I feel like you have a lot of advantages already having been there before and knowing how that all feels.
Most definitely. Yeah. I have to agree with that. I mean, it's definitely a different ballgame, especially mm-hmm. when you're stepping onto the big stage. I mean, she's done great things throughout her career. And
yeah.
She's been in the cage. She's been in the boxing ring. She's been in the spotlight. But when you walk out there and you're in front of thousands of people and you're on the biggest stage yet,
right.
It's a different ballgame. When you have everybody under the sun believing in you, there's a lot of pressure there.
Yeah. It's almost better to sneak in under the radar without expectations, you know?
Yeah, you're right. And, I mean, you know, it's frustrating for me because my whole career I've been the underdog.
Yeah.
That's frustrating. I think I deserve a lot more credit.
Yeah.
But you know what? I don't really care what people think. It takes a lot of pressure off of me. Mm-hmm. It just gives me the chance to just go in there and perform and do what I love. Nice. So that's one thing that I have an advantage of. I don't have to worry about that pressure. I mean, mm-hmm. heck, the whole world thinks I'm going to lose. Good for you guys. I mean, I'm not worried. I know what I carry, and I know that she's pretty much walking into my home.
Yeah.
So, I mean, good luck to her.
It's great. Well, and last night on that card, out of 10 fights, 9 underdogs paid off. So apparently, I have to read the articles, but they were saying something like, all the sports books in Vegas were like, holy, like, everybody, you know, all these dogs paid off, and some of them were big.
Right.
You know what I mean? So, I wouldn't count anybody out. You know what I mean? You never know. Quite the underdog against pretty much. You know, Ron is always favored against everybody, and I know you've been inside the cage with Kat. How do you think that fight will go down?
I think it's going to be exciting. I don't really know how to feel about it, honestly.
Yeah.
I mean, Kat's tough on stand-up.
Mm-hmm.
Rhonda's still every fight she showcases something new.
Yeah,
she went from just being this armbar queen to everybody saying they were sick of that, and then all of a sudden she's just showing knockouts, doing all kinds of crazy things.
Mm-hmm.
Kat's also a wrestler and a grappler. I mean, that's where she's comfortable at. But at the same time, Rhonda's done judo forever, and she's been a grappler and on the ground. So I think it's going to be a pretty good challenge. It's going to come down to who wants it most, and I mean, who's willing to go for it, you know? You got to push. You got to beat the other person
mm-hmm.
in those transitions, and you got to control the pace, so I think that's what it's really going to come down to.
And I also get the feeling, you know, Rhonda intimidates a lot of women and you know, just in the moment. And Kat has been through so much crap in her life. This poor woman has just seen the worst, like, had some of the worst things ever happen, you know, in terms of injuries and things in her personal life that have gone wrong. I think she's quite a strong woman who I doubt will be intimidated.
There could be.
You know,
Buster Douglas.
You know what I mean? I don't know.
This could be Tyson's first loss.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting. Well, I know you guys have a lot of things planned. You're going to be doing the open workout on Wednesday and everything, right?
Yeah.
Well, I will be at UFC tonight, but Wade will be there, so we'll make sure that we get some footage of you there as well. And, you know, if there's anything you need, this is what I love, is a home game, Pete. So if you need anything, I live like 10 minutes from downtown.
So paper towels, if you run out of toilet paper, whatever you need.
And I would say I'd cook you a meal, but I know, you're pretty good on your weight, though. Usually you don't have to struggle too hard, right?
No, actually, I have my body figured out.
Yeah.
Science. I cut 17 to 18 pounds each fight. I might look like I'm small, but I actually cut a lot of weight.
Yeah.
Right. I have a lot of muscle on me.
Yeah.
Even though I got my little Mexi roll. Don't
yeah, I know.
no, I mean, I figure it out, and usually Thursday is when I start my weight cut.
Yeah.
And then I'll cut whatever I need to.
Yeah.
Relax, go to sleep, float. I wake up in the morning, eat some food, and actually hydrate a little bit before I do my final weight cut.
Nice. So. Well, and I'm pretty sure you guys are all at the Biltmore downtown, which they claim is haunted. Just give me a heads up.
Yeah, great. Don't go in a room 706. Yeah. That's all I'm saying. That's all I'm saying.
No, actually, that'll be your room. He's just, you know what I mean? Could you imagine?
Yeah, you're going to jinx me.
I've been down there, and I didn't know that, but Chris Costello, you know, who does UFC PR and stuff, we were talking about the other day, and he said that he'd heard that place was haunted, and then somebody else said it, too. I didn't know that.
But isn't every old downtown hotel haunted? I mean, come on, if you've been in a hotel in a city for over 200 years and you're not haunted yet, you haven't had much traffic.
All right, well, in that case, since you offered if I need anything, I'm going to crash at your place.
Yeah, you can come crash at our place, or we've actually got some ghost hunting tools, apparently, at our house as well, right? So, for real, if there's anything you need, just definitely give me a shout, because I know, you know, during fight week, all of a sudden, you're like, I forgot to pack my such and such, so... But I'm excited. So UFC 184, history being made, women in the main and co-main event.
Yeah.
I'm very excited about this. Maybe more than you are.
A monumental weekend for women.
It really is. It really is awesome. Well, thank you so much for talking with us today, and we will see you in a couple of days.
Sounds good. Thanks for having me.
Thanks, Rocky.
Bye.
Pete, she can totally beat you up. And me. I'm not taking myself out of the equation. She would wreck me. But
no, she would. Yeah, she would kick the shit out of me.
Totally.
It would. It would be.
How does it make you feel?
I'm all right with her kicking the shit out of me. She's pretty. I've seen her fight. I don't think there's any harm in losing to her. Now, I don't want her to beat me up in front of my sons. That might be a little bit disheartening. But, you know, I'm okay. You know, it's a little girl in the pink dress. She beats me up.
Right.
Then I'm,
We got
trouble. Yeah.
Well, I'm curious, too, about it because, you know, we're making a big deal about this being the first card headlined by female fights, main and co-main. You know, obviously Invicta does that all the time. The cards are all female. But for the UFC, it's a big deal. You know, but I know that some people are still not down, you know, with watching women fight. So what, do you know people that, like, they might say, oh, yeah, cool, I'm was ready to watch Weidman, but I'm not going to watch the Ronda fight. You know, how do you...
You know, every time I've taken someone to, you know, to a bar to watch the fights and they've had that attitude, mm-hmm. that attitude immediately changes as soon as they watch a fight. I mean, you watch a fight and you're just watching great athletes with a lot of determination mm-hmm. and a lot of passion. And the women fights, to me, are a little bit different than, again, like, they don't pace themselves as much. And it really is, like, to me, it looks more like a fight and less like a sport mm-hmm. than when the guys do it. And, case in point, the big cut, that other girl who had the ear hanging off.
Right.
Like these women are in a fight for their life.
Right.
And so for anyone to go like, yeah, you know, chicks fighting, it's like, dude, you have two prime athletes basically fighting to what they consider in their minds the death,
right.
You know. And
yeah.
It, you know, it's pretty awesome. No, it's now, come on, you gotta give it up.
I think so. The one issue I do have, and I feel like as the sport evolves, we'll see this change. It's actually speaking to your point, where you see that they go in there and they're in a war and they're scrappier and they throw down more. I love that attitude. The only thing that bothers me, and I had this conversation with Brian and Michael, because Brian has trained alongside Holly Holm, is that, and, you know, guys, some of these guys have trained with women, is that sometimes I don't see enough defense, and I've talked about this before. I don't see enough defensive boxing from women. I just don't see enough defense. And I don't know if that's because of the mindset is that when they first walked into the gym and everybody was giving them grief, you can't be here, you're not tough enough, that you focus so much on offense and proving your worth, you know what I mean, and you're, you know, getting your aggression out, that that forward motion, that offense is top of mind. And I feel like as it evolves and as these, you know, as the divisions get deeper, as the sport evolves, where we have women who have been good at it for a number of years, I feel like that whole skill set, yeah, is going to rise. And we're going to see more of that strategic fighting and that, you know, not that I want it to go to point right. fighting, but I do want to see a little bit more defense because I feel like too many women take too much to give it back.
Right. No, there's so much newer to the sport yeah. than guys are. There's so much newer to the sport of fighting. And yeah. and like even boys, I got twin boys, they mm-hmm. wrestle, they fight. And I know somebody who's twin girls and they don't wrestle and right. they don't fight.
Right.
And so before this became a sport for women, when they fought, it was, holy shit, somebody's trying to rape me, or holy shit, yeah. somebody's trying to, and, you know, and it was just, you know, fight or flight. So, yeah, I think, you know, mm-hmm. no, it's definitely, I mean, you know, look at Ronda Rousey.
Yeah.
She's a, you
yeah,
know, she's, you know, yeah, she's amazing.
But that's the thing, and I say that, but I also love, and it's just like, you girl, just bite down on that mouth guard and just go for it, girls. Just smash something.
No,
I love that.
It's really exciting.
It's awesome. And I guess it's because I can personalize it more that I want to see more defense because I know how much that would hurt. You know what I mean?
Right,
you guys,
right.
I know you guys have like literally thicker skin and stuff like that, and your bones and your face are not as delicate and stuff like that. Like I think really a part of it comes from. What are you now? Have I just insulted your lineage? Your fancy white man lineage.
You got thicker skin, a big brow. Ear hair. No.
So dudes don't have that. That's
no,
not why you're supposed to be the protectors out in the wild.
Do you
all
guys
of a sudden,
have
I gotta
skin?
Do everything.
Do you guys have thicker skin than women?
I think you would. Yeah, you can shave your face every day, Pete. Clearly you don't. But yeah, like if I, no, of course you do.
Really? All right. I don't know.
Really?
Hey, all right.
I thought that was, I mean, sure,
well, no,
of course you do.
I knew, like, bone density and muscle mass. I didn't know about thicker skin.
I
learned
think.
Something.
I mean, maybe
I learned
I'm
something
just
new.
Making
as long as you're not
up.
Lying again, I've learned something new. Might want to Google that, bitch.
No, I that, to me, makes sense.
Thank
literally,
God.
I don't know. Like, our skin is more to,
okay, no, I mean, no, Karyn, you have very nice skin. A girl would love to have your skin.
Now you sound like, put the lotion on the body, the good girl.
Is there a segue to get help me? Get me out of here.
At any rate, UFC 184 is going to be great. Where are you going to watch? I'll be downtown. I know I'm sorry I wasn't able to bring you along with. Where are you going to watch?
Is it pay-per-view?
Hell yeah.
Oh, of course, yeah.
Prelims on Fox.
I'm gonna watch
One,
it I'm gonna watch it at Gold Sports Cafe.
All right, nice,
on
nice,
Third
nice.
Street.
No, that's cool. That's cool. You're gonna bring your wino friend, your little ascot wearing wine.
Chardonnay. We're gonna
get
a couple
of
Chardonnays and
fight.
Order a couple salads and watch it go.
So, anyway, listen, I want to move from Rocky, who is fighting on Saturday night. We're going to get to the guy who's fighting the night before, Liam McGeary. Liam, I met when he was training with DC. DC brought him out to play the role of John Jones because Liam is tall, lanky, long arms, long legs. And so DC had him come out to San Jose and train with him. And I met him when we were in Phoenix. From the UFC on Fox show. Really cool guy. And he's fighting for the light heavyweight title against Emmanuel Newton. So, we may as well get him in here as well and just.
Let's do it.
All right. All right, everybody, we are now joined by Liam McGeary. He is fighting for the Bellator light heavyweight title against Emmanuel Newton. That's going down Friday the 27th on Spike at Bellator 134. And Liam, dude, you feeling it? Are you feeling like it's your time? Because Emmanuel is good. But these days, you've been looking ridiculously ready.
He is good, but he's not met someone like me yet, so we'll see how good he is.
Nice. Well, listen, I was showing Pete before we were on here. I was like, no, dude, you got to see this highlight. Watch this. It's hilarious. And I'm sorry, you know, for the guys who lose at your expense, but when you drop somebody in 22 seconds and their legs just are, like, fold in, it's kind of comical.
Oh no, yeah, he melted into that stage.
Totally did. Plus, what I love is you throw one punch, you're like, my work here is done. The walk-off KO is the best.
No, he looked like a newborn giraffe. The feet just went out, the thing just went down. Like, I've never seen limbs go in so many different directions. It's like
I don't think it's worked that combination ice skating. Well.
Like, the limbs just went everywhere.
So what do you think the biggest danger is with Emmanuel? He's one of these weird guys. Like, sometimes when you see him fight, you don't really think he should win. I was at the fight when he fought King Mo, and he's kind of this weird guy, and then the next thing you know, he's totally beating somebody up. So strategically, what do you think is the way to beat him?
Just not lose concentration, really.
Yeah.
You know, I think a lot of people have got in there and they've underestimated his skills. Mm-hmm. They've underestimated him completely, you know, and look what happened. They got knocked out or beaten up, and he's a grinder. He can fight for 5 rounds. He's mm-hmm. got cardio. He's tough. He can take a punch. He's a slippery bugger on the floor. He can get out of submissions. So, yeah, man, he's every right to champion. So I'm going to just go in there and do what I do and take it off him, you know?
Nice. Well, you know, obviously you've got your submissions. Did you actually win submission of the year for the inverted triangle?
Yeah, the Bazzi Award.
Yeah, the Bazzi. We love Baz. That was amazing. Is that something that you really practiced a lot, you know, or was that one that you found yourself in and you were like, oh my God, this is like the sweetest thing I found myself in?
No, I mean, I'm in the gym training and I catch a few people in that. So it's something I work on. I've got a lot of stuff off my back, you know, so yeah. I'm comfortable on my back, although my coach has always yelled at me for staying down on my back for so long. But
oh, yeah.
I don't mind being down there, you know. But the judges, they look at the fight as though, oh, you're losing your fight, you're down on your back. Mm-hmm. So, but I mean, I don't mind being down there. So, but I have been working, getting up and changing and moving things around. So, yeah, I mean, I'm fully prepared in every area what we're going to go to.
Nice. You know, it's funny. I just had that conversation with Alan Joban, who's fighting the same weekend you are the next day. And same thing, like he's an active guy on his back. He's got that, you know, active guard. He's doing a lot. But it's something about like the judging they don't quite understand when you guys are actively searching for submissions and maybe you don't get the points, you know, the credit that you should.
Yeah, that's what I mean. And that's why I don't leave it to the judges.
Yeah.
You know, because you could be beating up the guy on the back there just holding you down, but you're hitting him in the face right. with elbows and you're kicking them, and mm-hmm. they haven't even landed a strike on you, you know? So yeah. I don't understand the whole wrestling type side of things for the sport where they get the points, but unfortunately that's the way the rules go. Mm-hmm. So that's why they judge it that way.
Yeah. Well, you also have the benefit of your legs are what, like 7 feet long?
Yeah, 4 foot long. Four foot long legs.
It's amazing. It's like you see these, you're like, oh, he's in a spider web. This dude is so done right now. Like, it's great. Well, and you know, obviously, I know you do a lot of your training with Henzo at the gym there. Were you working with Sapo at all for this fight?
Yes, me and Sapo worked together. Me and David Branch worked together. Yeah. A few of the other guys, Wayne Barrett, has also been floating around helping us out here and there. So, yeah, man, I've had real top guys pushing me and taking me to the points where I never thought I could go to. Mm-hmm. And then we went past them. And then, obviously, I had my stint over in San Jose with DC as well. Yeah. So I've had some good training partners for this camp. And it's been, you know, I started this camp, I think it was the day after Thanksgiving. Mm-hmm. I flew back from Atlanta early and was starting training then. So I've been going for a long time. Yeah. I'm preparing myself.
Well, we'll get into the DC stuff, but with Sapo, you know, in his last fight when he fought Tom Watson, you know, I know that Rafael is good, but like all of a sudden I was like, who's this dude? Like,
he looked completely different.
Amazing. And I don't mean that, you know, to disrespect the kind of fighter he was before, but I was blown away at how good he looked against Tom Watson.
He was awesome. That was the best he's ever looked, man. It was good. As soon as I see him as well, it was like, nice, man.
Yeah,
good.
Yeah. We got to talk to him after the fight. He was so fired up and just so happy. And that's great. I mean, I know that's somebody that can push you well. But, yeah, so I met Liam in December. We were in in Phoenix. And I can vouch for you, Liam, that you are working very hard. We're trying to get him to go out. Okay, so we're there with DC, who, you know, who's like a real, you know, fun guy, and he's there and he's playing the part of John Jones for DC, you know, to get ready all long and lanky and everything. But you know, DC had a fight coming up, so he wouldn't go out, but I have my girls with me, my makeup and my wardrobe and my glam squad, and we're going out. I'm like, well, we need like a bodyguard. Like, we you know. So I'm trying to get Liam to come out. And he's like, nope. He was diligent. He went back to the hotel room. He stayed in. He didn't come out with us. He was on lockdown. This man wants his title.
So you're so you're pretty bad influence.
I'm a very bad influence.
I can see him saying, no, I'm not coming out. And he's like, are you sure? No, I can't.
I did.
I'm training.
He did, and so that's when we were all leaving after, I guess it was after the weigh-ins or something like that, or maybe it was after the show, I forget which night it was, but we were sort of like, you're really sure? You don't want to come out of the three, you know, and he's like, no, I'm good. And then we called him again, like, we're like, and then I think I woke him up. I feel bad. It wasn't that late.
It was about 1 o'clock in the morning. No. I was gone.
You were kind of crossing the harassment line there.
I mean,
you know, if you'd been the woman and you'd been the guy, it would have gotten creepy, actually.
But I'm with Dale and Tracy. They're like, no, he should come out with it. Just call. He's not staying in. That's ridiculous. You need.
You
to call
don't need
him.
To. Your fight's miles away. You've got weeks and weeks of training.
Weeks.
I was like, no.
Weeks.
God, 2 days. I had 2 days off over Christmas.
Yeah, that's it.
Straight back in the gym. New Year's Day, sparring in the gym. It was, I'm onto this. This is my title, yeah. And I'm going to go get it.
Well, this is why he's a champion, and I'm
And well, we're just lazy people who are going to be watching you with a cheeseburger in our hands right there.
Oh, I'll have the cheeseburger as well. Don't worry about that. I just train hard.
So listen, you know, much has been made about this show being, you know, the British invasion, they're calling that, and people talking about you having the opportunity to be the first British champ. Is that something that, you know, that you really care about? Not that you wouldn't have pride in your country, but is that something that you also really want to achieve, or do you just want to get this title just for the sake of proving to yourself that you're the best?
I think a little bit of both, yeah. Really. Yeah, I mean, it's a great honor to be the first champion, first English guy to win a major title over here. And also, I want it because I want to be the champion, you know? Yeah. I want to be the best person out there and take on anyone that is coming to get it, you know? Mm-hmm. My friend, David Branch, he's the WSOF champion, so... Yeah. The pair of us, we both won our belts, and we're going to defend them.
Nice. Well, we need more talent from there, too, because I was working with Bisbing, and we were talking about some of the guys, and I know that, you know, it's a place with a rich boxing history. You know, we love our Ricky Hatton, and if you're including Wales, you know, you got Joe Calzaghe and stuff, if you're talking about, you know, great boxing history coming from over across the pond. But there, you know, there needs, I know there's more of you guys there. Like, we just.
Oh, there's loads. There's loads. But just nobody's been discovered yet.
Yeah. What is it? Is there, do you not feel the support system at home enough, though, that you needed to come over here and train and fight here more?
America's it's very big on the MMA scene, and England is still a little bit behind for what I thought, you know, because I lived in Jersey, so where in Jersey there is no MMA, you know, so there was one show being put on. The guy, he's actually here, the promoter, he's come and watched the fight, but so he put the show on, and there really wasn't anyone behind. They don't really know about MMA. They don't really know what it is. They just think, oh, cage fighting, you know? And it's like, oh, it's two guys and fighting to the death in a cage. It's like, no, man, it's a lot more to this, you know?
Yeah.
So they're now starting to get schooled on what MMA is.
Yeah.
As for the English circuit, there was always a few... there's always a few organisations putting fights on, but I moved away from England a long time ago, so I never really went back there. And then I always want to move forward with my life, you know, and the opportunity in America came up, so I grabbed it with both hands.
Yeah, nice. Well, obviously, Henzo's is a great gym to train out of. I know, you know, Frankie Edgar is there a decent amount of the time, right?
Yeah, he pops by every now and then. He more trains at Ricardo Almeida's place.
Right. Yeah, but
which is another Henzo, but in New Jersey.
Yeah. But so you actually live in Jersey?
No, I live in the Bronx in New York.
Oh, you live in the Bronx. I was going
to
say.
But I had to come to New Jersey today, so I've just jumped on the bus.
Oh, okay. Yeah, because I don't know, Jersey, I don't really, Jersey for you, I don't know, I'm not seeing it. The Bronx sounds a little bit more appropriate.
No, I mean, I was here for a little while before, maybe a couple of years, a year or so.
Yeah.
But it was just, you need a car to get around everywhere, and I knew we'll drive on the wrong side of the road to me, so it's easier to get around on a train in New York.
Nice, nice. And you have, well, this is an easy fight because the fights are right up in at the Mohegan Sun, right? So that's easy. Yep. Are you a gambling man yourself too? Because you know, you can there, you can dabble a little in a bit of a little blackjack.
I like to play roulette.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, nice. Roulette. I could sit there for a while and play that one.
What do you bet on? What are your numbers?
I just put them anywhere I feel them. Oh, here, one there, one there, one there. Someone black, this one.
Is there any strategy in roulette? There's like no.
No, well, I don't know. I guess some people will think there's strategy, but me, man, it's just pure luck. Guess where I go. If it comes in, it comes in. If it doesn't, stick more chips down.
Yeah. I like to. There's certain numbers that I try to play all the time, and I do sort of try to pay attention to the list that says, you know, if red is hit. You know, okay, then you think, okay, a black one is due or whatever, but like, obviously, every single time it's still 50-50, so it doesn't really matter.
It doesn't matter, yeah.
But you feel like if you see a bunch of red ones, you're like, oh, it's gotta be, well, black is coming up.
First time I played roulette, I thought I had the system, right? I'm gonna put it on red, and then I'll just keep doubling up, right, until eventually red's gonna hit. But but there were like 12 blacks in a row, and I'm like sweating all my money. I gotta borrow more money.
Man, you should know. Always bet on black.
And then it finally hits, and I'm like, that was the hardest $5 I've ever won in my life.
Well, you apparently don't even know. What was it? It was that old commercial that said, always bet on black. It was, what's his name? Billy D. Williams, I think it was, or something like that. And it was for something. But yeah, no, I play like my birthday and, you know, my daughter's birthday. It's, you know, just ridiculousness. Actually, I want to get back to the DC thing. What did you think of his fight with John and like the stuff that you guys trained together? Did you see, like, were you watching that fight a little frustrated? Like, oh, I know DC can do this and he didn't pull it off in the fight?
Yeah, I was a little bit. You know, I'm sad for him. You know, I know what he was doing and I know he was working hard, mm-hmm, and I know what he was doing in his training camp. So it's like to watch him fight, and I was like, dude, go for it. Take him down, you know? It's like, right. Grab, pick him up, throw him around, do what he was doing to me, man, you know?
Yeah.
But it's a shame. It really is a shame, mm-hmm, you know? But he's going to get it. He'll get another chance. Nice. You know, he'll go back and he'll definitely do it this time, you know?
And are you able to process those lessons you watched of DC fighting for the title in your own head now? Did that help you, you know, sort of align your thought process and make sure that you get your head right on Friday?
Yes. Yeah. Yes, it definitely does. You know, that's why I've been so focused. Mm-hmm. You know, as soon as I come back from DC, I was at Christmas.
Yeah.
My brother came over. I was like, listen, man, I'm not going to be doing any partying. I'm in the gym. And I've spent all the time in the dungeons, man. Look at me. I look like a bloody caveman, you know. I come out, I eat, and then I go back down there.
That's good stuff, though. So listen, if you are able to, if and when you you win this title, how active do you want to be? I know you did the tournament before, but how many fights do you think you'd like to have this year?
Well, 5 fights in a year was was a lot. You know, I was tired.
Oh, yeah.
And so, I mean, I don't know. I mean, if they pay well, then 3 maybe or 4. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I just want to earn some money.
Yeah.
You know, I'm hungry, you know.
Well, and I think the obvious question for a lot of people is, you know, what kind of deal do you have at Bellator? I know Scott Coker, I've known him before from when he worked with Strikeforce. I've known him a long time, and I know he's a very smart man who obviously knows how to run an organization. But I know a lot of people, you know, are wondering what's going to happen over there and how long some of you guys are signed.
I win the title, and then we'll see after that, you know?
Yeah. Oh, that's so you get to renegotiate after you win the title. Sweet. That's nice. That's some bargaining power right there.
Ball's in my court then.
Yeah, so that's
even more. That's even more reason for me to just focus on what I'm doing, mm-hmm, and concentrate, you know? Yeah. But, like, I'm not overlooking anything. I know who I've got. It's very tough opponents, so... Mm-hmm. I'm putting the work in, and I'm going to take it from him.
Nice. Well, our buddy Sheck Congo is on the same card with you. We just saw him the other day out here in L.A., and he's just I don't know if you know him at all, but if you don't know him, seek him out.
I've met him a couple of times.
He's a lovely guy.
I've met him a couple of times.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, and I hope that – are you going to take a vacation, take a holiday after this?
I have to go to England to sort out my visa.
Yeah.
But I've been talking to my girlfriend. I was in Jamaica last year, so I think we're talking about Croatia this time.
Oh, really?
Wow. Yeah, yeah. So we're gonna check out that place.
Nice.
See what that's like. Yeah.
Where in Jamaica did you go? You know, I'm half Jamaican, so I think we talked about this before because we had the "What Are You" conversation.
He's not hanging out with you.
Come
and your
hang
friends.
Out. He's just bringing his girlfriend.
Listen,
my husband's here.
No means no. Okay. Respect the guy.
I need to party with Liam. He owes me.
Wait till I get that title, and then we'll party.
Where in Jamaica did you go?
Ocho Rios.
It's a great place. It's a great place. Yeah. No, but actually, we did have this conversation. We were in the van going to the show. I was like, all right, Liam, I'm sure you get the "What are you" question. And I know people are going to be looking at here and trying to ask. We know you're British, but what in fact is the breakdown?
It's a bit Scottish, bit of English, and West African.
That's right. That's pretty cool. Yeah. It's pretty cool. So I got the West Indian, and which is part Scottish, the whole Jamaica Walker Scottish thing. It's cool.
I'm just a bunch of pasty white people. Had an orgy, and I came out. Scott, British, Wales. They just thought, hey, let's go.
I just brought it all in there.
Nice. Well, you know, if your negotiations don't go well with Scott Coker, there is going to be a UFC show in Glasgow later this year.
Oh, really?
Yeah. It's in, I want to say June or July, but yeah, there is a Glasgow show coming up. So I'm just saying, you get that title, you have some offers somewhere else. I'm guessing you would get some offers.
I'm going to push it. We're going to win this because there's so many English dudes fighting in Bellator now.
Yeah.
There has to be a show being put on in England somewhere. Yeah. Yeah. You know, because the fans want to see a Bellator over there. We've
For
got
sure.
a British We're going to have a British champion. So it's definitely going to have to go across the pond.
For sure. Well, and like I said, I know Scott is a really smart guy, and he's aggressive, you know, in what his goals are, and he did a lot with Strikeforce.
He's
so.
Shown it already.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. So like I said, I'm not trying to convince you to jump ship. I'm just saying it's going to be interesting to see what happens after you get that title, because I have a feeling it's going to be a hot property, so... It's nice.
Yeah.
Nice.
Bellator's my home.
No, it's great. Well, listen, obviously it's working for you. This is the one thing I do have to bring up, though, speaking of working. So you're 9-0, which sounds like awesome. You're like, yeah, man, I'm 9-0. I'm like a badass fighter. But supposedly it's all come down to only like 10 minutes of fight time.
I know, yeah.
You lazy son of a bitch.
I put the work in the gym.
Hold on. So those...
You're working in the gym. I know.
So those five fights in a year was actually like 6.5
minutes? Well, one of them took a minute and a half. One of them took 22 seconds. One of them was like, what, maybe 3 minutes?
No, the final was, I think he tapped 12 seconds from the end of the first round.
Oh, right in the end. That's right. Okay.
But I spent most of the time lying on the back.
Yeah, you did. But I still think that sounds so badass.
Yeah,
it's like, yeah
totally.
I'm 9-0, and I've worked for 10 minutes inside the cage. Boom. Drop the mic and walk away. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, imagine this one. I win this in the first round. How become a champion in 15 minutes.
That'd be amazing. And then you put out a video, 15 minutes to the title.
Yeah,
and like put your own workout video or whatever.
That's it. 15 minutes to a championship.
That's awesome. Well, we do know that Emmanuel can go deep. Like we said, he can go a lot of rounds. So you do probably have to get in there and get off first and get, you know, meet first and go in there and take it to him, right?
But, babe, the fight's going to go how the fights go, you know? And if we go five rounds, we'll go five rounds. I'm more than happy to go five rounds.
Nice.
I mean, all the training I put in there doesn't... I train hard for nine rounds, 10 rounds, and it's still repetitive on and on and on going. Fresh guys come in, fresh guys go out, you know? It's we work hard.
Yeah.
You know, they like I say, they've pushed me to the absolute maximum, and I'm glad for it. I feel great.
Awesome.
Absolutely amazing.
Awesome. Well, I can't wait. Well, it's happening on Friday, the 27th at Bellator 134. Liam McGeary taking on Emmanuel Newton for the light heavyweight title. I want to say thank you for doing this today. I know you're busy now. You're just everybody wants to talk to you. So thank you for taking the time. You're just driving up to Connecticut, right? You'll just drive up. Are you going tonight, tomorrow?
No, we go tomorrow. So I'm in Jersey now. I have to go back to the city tonight. I'll pack and then I'll leave. I've got another couple of interviews to do before I leave and then go.
Nice. We'll just leave room for the belt in your bag, right?
Oh, there's plenty of room. I'm taking a separate bag specially for it.
Nice. Awesome, Liam. Well, it's been great talking to you. Best of luck. We'll see you in action.
Thanks,
on Friday.
Take it easy. See you later, my man.
I'm telling you, this dude would not come out. I tried. My girls were like, come on! Well, it's because we all have big mouths, and like we were like, we might need backup. We really might need somebody to come save us. Because, you know, when I go out with my friends, they're single. And so I've told you this before, how I'm the greatest wing woman in the world, because I will talk to the ugly person, the ugly friend, or whatever. I got nothing invested in it. But we were thinking, you know, like it is, it's like, I don't get afraid, you know, many places, but it is a legitimate concern sometimes that, like, oh, you know, yeah, what if we did run into, like, weirdos or, whatever. Right. Like, it might, you know, if you had somebody like Liam with you, you know what I mean? The situation would probably get diverted or something very
maybe
quickly.
That's why you didn't go with him. I mean, he didn't go with you. That's sort of, you
he
know.
He didn't want to be the...
Well, hey, why don't you come with us and then you can protect us as we shoot our mouth off.
No, I would have.
I think maybe like, hey, why don't you come with us because my two single friends like to drink randy. You're a pro fighter. And you do the math. He's got a girlfriend.
He's got a girlfriend. Well, that's what I was going to say because I don't want to put my girl's business out there, but they were both found him appealing. And... you know, wouldn't have minded spending some time with him.
So you're basically pimping out your girls. Yeah.
They don't watch this, I don't think.
Does nobody watch this show, Karyn? Not even your girls.
Anyway.
So would they have slept with him?
Oh, God, Pete, I don't know if they're doing that.
You look like you're so shocked all of a sudden. Hold on.
Does it go from...
Let me change to my 19th century Amish outfit. I thought we were going out Las Vegas girls.
Couldn't we all hang out and they get their little flirt game on? Why does it got to go directly from...
I'm sorry. You could have gone out. I skipped over plain Parcheesi.
So my girls are big whores, is apparently what you're saying. They met him on Thursday, and they're in the sack with him on Friday, because that's how they roll.
You told me they found him attractive. You're talking about going out in Vegas. It's shocking. Shocking. I know.
Okay. Phoenix.
Phoenix. Phoenix. Sorry. Phoenix is... So they could have golfed with him? They could have...
I mean, my goodness. That's what you think now. It's just that easy.
I think if you're going out in Phoenix, it's a totally different story.
So to answer your questions, no, they would not have slept with him. Yes, maybe we needed some backup because we're loudmouths. See... We also would have fed him and bought him some drinks if he wanted to roll this. He's a fun guy. Who doesn't want to hang out with three chicks? Apparently.
Three chicks.
That was your title.
Three chicks who won't sleep with you who have big mouths and who just want you for
three
protecting
chicks.
Them for
three
their
chicks.
Mouths.
Three chicks. Bellator title. Priorities are in the right place.
Three chicks who want to be friends and Bellator title. Here's the thing is, my wife has a British accent, but his accent's awesome.
His is awesome.
Because, like, he can say anything and it just sounds fun.
Yeah.
He can, you know, it's like...
That's why we wanted to hang out with him. He's a cool guy.
Yeah. Well.
But plus, I just wanted to throw people off. I just wanted us to walk down the streets and be like, what are they? Like, what is that? What are they? What are they doing? What is that?
Now, would they have made out with him if given the chance?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
But he has a girlfriend, and he said he had a girlfriend,
So they would have made out with him.
Yes.
Would they have let him maybe feel them up?
I don't know.
Well, because you were just so shocked with the sleeping, and you've admitted to the making out, so we've got first base, a home run shocking. Second? What have you gotten to second base with him?
I hope Liam has turned off this podcast by now if he checked it out to see how his interview went.
And first of all, apologies to his girlfriend.
Yeah,
who
wasn't there and who may be a lovely girl. I would imagine
she's a lovely girl. Anyway, he was super cool.
Yeah, he is. Good luck to him. And, you know, it's funny because when we have people on, and we wish them the best of luck, and, you know, tell them to go get that belt. I do sometimes think, you know, what if their opponent's like, well, damn, they're, like, picking sides. I mean, I just always say that when I want people, just, like, get after it. Go for it, man. If it's your time, go take it, you know?
And
it's
you awesome. Got to come on the show.
We want to root for us.
If you come on the show, I root for you.
We root for you. That's right. Yeah. That's right. So Holly Holm is going down. And Emmanuel Newton going down.
Down.
Nice.
Emmanuel Newton. That's a heck of a name.
It is. It is.
Did he discover some science thing?
I know. It sounds like he should have. And he comes out to heavy metal, which throws people off because he's a black dude. And apparently people's brains can't process it. Black people like metal. They don't know what to do.
Black people like metal?
Some people. I don't know.
Put that in down. In my another stereotype shattered book.
Listen, Pete. Last night we were. I was at work. Fight night. There was an Oscar show going on as well at the same time, and I say there was a room full of people who wanted to punch somebody. And there was a room full of people actually punching somebody. I feel like there really was more in common than maybe
they
we're giving them credit.
I hate the Oscars.
Do you hate them?
You know what it is? Why do we... Okay, first of all, Oscar, Golden Globe, Spirit Awards, this, that. Like, as if, like, celebrities haven't had their asses kissed enough. Like, now we're right. Like, oh, let's all devote a night to talking about how great you guys are.
Well, it'd be a different story if... we all got to vote. Do you know what I mean? Like, that's the thing about it is it's everybody in there patting each other on the backs.
And they all vote for themselves.
Exactly. So, or my good friend, or this one, or that one. It would actually be fascinating if we, the people, got to vote for the Oscars. You know, but don't poo-poo all of that, because I really want an Emmy. Like, I want an Emmy so bad. I really want an Emmy. Yeah, listen, Pete, I worked a long time.
Karyn, I... I want to validate you right now without an Emmy. I want to say that you're worth it, you're special, and damn it, you're really good.
I'd like to thank.
I want to give you.
No, you didn't
my
even know.
Los Angeles Kings Stanley Cup. The original, 2012.
I practice my Emmy speech. I do. I'm going to get an Emmy. Hmm. I really want an Emmy.
Speaking of the speeches.
Okay, yes. So let's praise or pummel this. Patricia Arquette got up and won for Best Supporting Actress for Boyhood, a film I did not see. Did you see it?
Yeah, I did see it.
Did you like it?
I did see it. You know, Boyhood was cool because it took 12 years to do. If you took out the fact that it took 12 years to do, was it a great film? No, it was a pleasant film.
Yeah.
But, you know, I mean, if you climb a mountain and it's really tough for you to climb, does that make the mountain any better once you get to the top? I don't know.
Okay. I haven't seen it, so I can't comment on it, but I hear what you're saying.
Really? That's cool, because I, like, totally lost.
No, I get that.
I was, like, halfway into that mountain thing.
If
I'm
anything,
like, what
you would
hell,
you would sort of maybe applaud the director, you know what I mean, Linklater or something like that, for the effort it took, you know what I mean? But, yes, it's the gestalt approach. Let's talk about it. The parts are, the gestalt approach would be that the whole is greater than the sum of the parts. But in this case, the effort of putting those parts together, shut up.
And the Emmy Award.
Don't act like you didn't
for her fantastic gestalt approach in outstanding German.
The irony is that he thinks he went to a better college.
I think it U.S. News and World Report thinks it.
Whatever. Anyway, she, in her speech, took the opportunity to say that to make a political statement.
Right.
And to say that it was time for women to have equal pay for equal work, because as it is right now, for every dollar a man earns, a white woman earns about, I think it was 78 cents, a black woman earns 60 something, a Latin American woman would only earn 50 something.
In the same job.
In the same job, yes. So I'm curious how you feel praising or pummeling the idea of taking that moment at an Oscar speech to make a political statement.
You know what? I actually praise it.
Yeah.
You got one moment. You won something. They've got you up in front of, a billion people? Mm-hmm. You got 30 seconds. You could either say something that's close to your heart that you think can affect people, or you can go, I'd like to thank my agent at ICM, Bob Turner, and my lawyer, Max Schreiber, and, you know, why? No, do it.
Yeah.
Do it. Listen, if I am to ever win anything, please, other than a participation trophy from Little League, and anyone puts a mic in front of me and goes, hundreds of millions of people are watching. I'm gonna say something that I think is important.
Yeah. Well, I agree with you. I'm gonna praise it as well, because I also think not only do I agree with the statement and with the cause that she was rallying behind.
So 78 cents a dollar?
I wouldn't make 78 cents a dollar. I would make 60 something. Okay. Did I just turn white? Did I at least win that?
Now, let me see. Let me see. One, okay.
What? No, Mr. Better College Math. It's obviously, like I said, the case she's arguing for. I obviously want that. But yeah, I agree. You know, for most of the time, the women at these award shows are only asked, who did your nails and what dress are you wearing? And they're judged and asked nothing but frivolous things. So for her to be able to put something of substance out there in that moment, I think is cool.
And listen, anytime someone's gonna stick a mic in front of you and go, we got 100 million people wanting to know what you think. Listen, you can go the Kardashian route and say nothing, or you can say something. And listen, we don't have to agree with what you say. Just listen, it's your moment.
Yeah.
Say it.
Yeah.
I'm totally for it.
Okay, so not at the Oscars, though. 50 Shades of Grey. won the box office again. It's made so far about $130 million. Meanwhile, movies like Jupiter Ascending, Seventh Son, all these things are tanking.
Okay. First of all, I actually...
I don't even know what the praise or pummel is. It's just a...
I was actually in the movie theater on Valentine's Day or the day after,
right,
taking my kids to some movie. And there were women dressed to the hilt going in groups to 50 Shades of Grey. And I watched them walk in, we watched our movie, and then I would like watch them, you know, walk out, and they were like all flushed.
What?
And it's like, I'm just gonna ask you, because you're a woman.
Yeah.
Do you know that there's pornography on the internet?
I know.
Like, I'm talking fucking hardcore
and
shit. I'm not talking like, why don't we take my necktie and bound your wrist together? I'm talking like a fucking donkey hitting you hard.
It's like, so romantic.
Yeah, 50 Shades of Grey. What is this, grandmother porn?
I don't get it. I have no. I'm.
Hello, put that file down. I need you to come with me.
I've heard it's terrible.
Meanwhile, I'm just saying. There's a whole smorgasbord of porn out there.
Maybe the acting was better in it, Pete.
Listen, when you got a donkey doing you, you ain't even acting at that point. You're reacting. That is a documentary. That's as real as it gets, man.
Wow.
There's no, that's pain.
It's, yeah,
that's
just,
so, anyway. So,
wow. So, yeah, so I was just going to say that, yeah,
So what was the praise of the pummel?
Yeah, the movie, I suppose. So you're pummeling it, clearly.
You know what? I haven't seen
it. I don't even see it.
I'm just pummeling the fact that there's, you know, women all aflutter.
If anybody has seen it, please give us a comment. I'm curious what people, what really it's like, you know, because... I don't know.
Well, there was that movie Secretary years ago.
Secretary was a little frisky. I mean, 9.5 weeks, if we're talking about the classic,
but
that was a great one.
All that was pre-porn. I mean,
yeah, okay.
Pre-internet.
Right.
I'm sorry, not pre-porn.
Yeah, Pete, come on.
Pre-internet.
Let's get
like,
serious.
So I can see, like, pre-internet. Like, ooh,
right,
there was a movie that I didn't have to feel really creepy and sit next to a creepy guy.
Right,
like,
I could
in
go.
I mean, back in the 70s, you want to go see porn, you actually had to sit in a dark theater next to God knows who.
Remember,
and watch it.
Taxi driver when he takes you on a date and he takes you to That's so creepy.
So I could see, like, you know, you're like, oh, Secretary, that I didn't feel completely ashamed
James
to go see.
James Spader and Maggie Gyllenhaal,
You know, ladies, you know, www and then put in the word hot and then you'll get about 20 different alternatives.
I didn't know that. News to me. I didn't know that there was... that on the internet.
Yeah, you know, hot, what?
Anything else bothering you, Pete? Anything else you want to pummel? Praise? I think you're good.
Yeah, I think I'm good.
I think I'm good.
I think I've pretty much killed all hopes of running for a political office. I was really hoping to run for Assemblyman.
Is that, right?
It's
is
not
going
to happen now.
So again, I want to remind everybody, we do have a UFC tonight this week, and then we're off for a couple of weeks. So we have that going on. But go to youtube.com/Karyn Bryant or go to our MMA Heat Facebook page. You will see that awesome story. We did an interview with Alan Joban, who is fighting at UFC 184. We've got an interview with Sheck Kongo, who's fighting at Bellator 134. He's fighting King Mo. So we talked to him about that. And also, he's got this cool win-back therapy that he's doing that's helped heal his injuries. It's done with radio waves and all that. So he walks us through how this whole thing works. Very cool. And it's really extended his like fight career. And it's a therapeutic thing that like non-invasive that people are going to be able to use for themselves as well. And we have Tony Ferguson on the way. We're working on that one as well. Nice interview with him. Such a cool guy. He's also at UFC 184. And I feel like, we'll certainly be covering 184 for MMA Heat. So if you're not already subscribed to the Karyn Bryant channel and the MMA Heat channel, do that because we'll have weigh-ins. We'll have lots of workouts because I believe Wade's going to go down and shoot the Invicta workout, open workouts too. So Chris Cyborg, she's fighting Charmaine Tweet on Friday night, so you'll be able to see some of that as well. And then we'll have, you know, press conferences and media day and all that fun stuff. So busy week for us here, Pete. I gotta stay hydrated. I gotta stay hydrated because my very thin skin here is gonna
beautiful skin.
It's not bad.
No, it's
I'll say this.
Good.
It's not bad for a 60-year-old woman. So yeah, thank you. And again, even though Pete doesn't take it, Alpha Brain is really good for you. So you can...
In fact, perhaps because I don't
because
take it.
Because
you
he
know
doesn't
it's,
take it.
That's pretty much a thumbs up for Alpha Brain, by the way.
MMAheat.com/onit, O-N-N-I-T. We'll get you 10% discount on the goods there. And you should be... what's your...
My noogie. My noogie.
What's your tweet activity like?
Tweet like... I'm gonna do one this week.
One.
Now you know what?
I did the tweet, kids. I used the tweet machine.
I did the tweet. You guys are always talking about. I told you what I had for lunch. No. I'm gonna tweet.
Mind noogie. You can find me on Twitter at Karyn Bryant, KarynBryant. You can follow me on Instagram. I'm trying to build up my Instagram. I'm getting into my Instagram game. I'm stepping up my Instagram game.
You got some photos? We're going to get some selfies?
Well, it's funny. I got to be honest with you. I've been edited on some, I've been overruled on some posts that I wanted to make.
Really?
Where? We were talking about this last week, last time. I've been overruled on some.
A little too sexy? A little too sexy?
Apparently.
Wow.
Yeah. Hey. So, but I am trying to step up my Insta game. But the cool thing is that, you know, I shoot a lot of fun stuff backstage, you know, at work and, you know, stuff with the guys, but, you know, and just, you know, stuff.
So what was edited? Can we throw up a picture that was edited with like a little black bar of
There was no nip. It was a close call. I mean, it was like a... But it got overruled.
And those are the ones that do so well.
Jeez. So I don't want him in my corner. I don't want him on my Instagram account.
It's lucky he's not married to a Kardashian, man.
Totally,
they'd have like
totally.
1,000 Twitter followers.
I know. A million. She's got like a million.
Kardashian?
She's got like millions. It's so sad.
She's got like over 17 million.
So sad. So sad. Anyway, thank you so much for joining us. If you're watching the video version of this, you can also find us on Stitcher and on iTunes. And if you're listening on iTunes and Stitcher, you can also find us on YouTube. So thank you. I want to thank Raquel Pennington and Liam McGeary for joining us. Good fun was had by all, I believe. So thanks for checking out the show, you guys. See you next time.
So long.